Copenhagen in December. It's cold, it's dark, it's wet. A bleakness and a dreariness which belies the crown that Denmark has been wearing for the past 2 years, that of the happiest country in the world. In 2012 and again this year, the UN commissioned a report which studied some 156 countries to find out which were the happiest. The top five are Sweden, the Netherlands, Switzerland, Norway, and in first place, Denmark. A happiness which is taken seriously in Denmark, where even a happiness institute was created to answer the soul-searching question of what makes one happy.
There's a high level of trust among Danes, in the Danish population. And it's not just trust among friends and family members, but it's very much trust to strangers. Security is another one. When you become unemployed, you can get benefits. When you become sick, you can go to the hospital and so on. We also see wealth is the third factor. That has importance to happiness as well. Denmark is not the world's richest country, but we are doing still quite well.
Bjørn Nygaard is a lawyer and a coach. Although his team may not exactly qualify for championship games, he doesn't care. The team includes his 7-year-old daughter. Bjørn admits he's lucky he lives in a country where the system allows him the time, the leisure to do this. But it's also a system where the Danes pay some of the highest taxes in the world.
Look at this place. This is all for free. I don't have to pay to come here and do this. The city built this for everyone to have fun here. And if some of the kids are falling or trembling and they are hurt, then they go to the hospital or wherever, and it's still for free. It's a lot of money to pay in taxes, but then again, you get something back for it. In general, I think we're just happy about the way it is. It's security. It really is.
A security that leads to happiness. It's one of the key arguments for not only Denmark, but for other countries which scored high in the happiness barometer. For the top five happiest countries, they're also among the top in having the shortest working week, balanced with a healthy average annual salary. But they also pay some of the highest taxes in the world, most notably in Sweden and Denmark. And another element of happiness? Jobs. These happiness laureates have unemployment levels well below the European Union average. And while there may not be such a thing as a perfect happiness, Bjørn and his wife Nana say they're satisfied. Satisfied they both have jobs, enjoy generous parental leaves for their children, and a feeling that equality and the freedom to choose are government priorities.
We don't consider ourselves totally happy every day, but of course, when you start to think about it, when you look at the points that they evaluate the countries, you see something about is it easy to have a family and a work life, and compared to other countries, yes, I think it's easier.
Yeah.
It's free for the children to go to school, and then also a system that functions. No corruption. When I talk to my Italian friends and they tell me about their politicians' lives, how they do everything for not paying taxes but still want everything they can get from the public, every support they can get but without paying taxes, then I feel happy that I'm here in Denmark with a functional system.
Denmark and its Scandinavian neighbors have been systematically ranked as having little or no corruption. And despite several referendums on reducing their high taxes, they've been maintained. The price to pay, they say, for equality.
There was a British ambassador to Denmark who did a book called, where he talked about the Danish tribe. He said Denmark is almost like a tribe, small, closed, everybody knows each other, everybody got the same name, things like that.
And entering such a tribe is not always easy. Natalia Corolla is Ecuadorian. She came to Denmark after marrying her husband Tommy, who's Danish. The conditions to stay were numerous. Among them, Tommy had to prove financial independence for the last 3 years. An 8,000 euro deposit was required for housing reasons. They both had to show their affinity to Denmark was stronger than the one they had to Ecuador. But the hardest part was to reveal their private life, to show theirs was not an arranged marriage.
Before you knew me, you didn't know that there was all these strict rules about immigration, you know, when people wanted to come into the country. Because that is what we experienced with your friends and then with the people that we met, that when we talked about what we had to go through, they were truly amazed. How could it be possible that there were so much strict rules and money you have to pay. So when they get to know this, they really get annoyed by it and thinking why Denmark is like that.
It's a balance, and I totally agree that it needs to be strict so nobody exploits the system. On the other hand, you know, people also want to be treated with dignity and respect, and a system that works the way the Danish system works sometimes tends to not look at the people but you as a number.
Despite its happiness crown, Denmark has been criticized for having some of the toughest immigration policies in Europe. Policies that have left some from the outside accusing Denmark of sometimes being less than welcoming, even xenophobic.